Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me well? Yeah, good. Even at the back? Good. Perfect, thank you. Sorry, we struggled a lot with the connectivity. Apparently, the projector doesn't like my laptop. But it's doing well. So I'm very happy to be here this morning for the discussion keynote today. To be honest, I always had a blast from here in India. Last time was in June in Bangalore. I presented the same session at the Global Scrum Gathering. It was very, very, very interesting. And again yesterday, I really, really enjoyed the session. Great talk, great speakers, a lot of questions that I found very, very interesting. There is always something to learn. So thank you. Thank you. And to me, it's an opportunity to, I know that it requires a lot of work to put together such an event. So I think it's a good opportunity to thank the organizers. So thank you a lot. Thank you. I really, really like this. So a few words about myself before I start. So my name is Sylvain. I hope it's going to work. So I often say that I have two lives. During the day, I work as an enterprise agile coach in Singapore. I lead a team of 30. I put the largest team of agile coaches in Singapore. Don't get too excited, you know, considering the size of Singapore, the largest team of coaches is like 10 people. So it's not that big. And we help, basically we help organizations adopt agile. At night and on weekends, I work as a life transformation coach. What is a life transformation coach? So basically, some of us, you know that, it's okay, but it should be better. So we know, we struggle, we know that something should be, we are looking for maybe a purpose in our life, or something more meaningful, we want to improve our life. So my job is to help people, identify what to do improve and help them improve. And so today I want to talk about my personal journey, this question. I think it's the first time. Can I borrow the agenda? Thank you. I think it's the first time that in a conference like this one, I see so many questions about questions. So yesterday, I'm an agile coach. What's my future? The nine lives of an agile coach. Practitioner, the role of an agile coach. And then the last one was titled, how to become an agile coach. Wow, looks like it's a very, very hot topic. So basically this morning I want to talk about my journey and more specifically about the day I realized that coaching is not what I thought it was. So my journey starts about 10 years ago. I guess like many of you have had a technical background. I started my career as a software developer, and after a few years, I did some project and program management. And 10 years ago, I was working on this, big package program. The program that is blinking red. The Titanic program, the sinking program. The quality is bad. There is no trust, no confidence with the client. People are very disengaged. They jump out of the window. They quit. And of course, as a program manager, it's very, very challenging. But I enjoy challenges. I enjoy, when things get tough. So I decided that probably it was the best time to take a gap year. So I took a year off, traveled to Australia and New Zealand. And before I left, a colleague of mine, I remember he told me, have you heard of this thing, Scrum, Agile? And I had heard about it a little bit, but I didn't know much. So when I was in the Australian outback, I read books, from Craig Larman, from Jeff Sutherland, all the thought leaders, the Popendix, the Lean Software Development, and I was like, wow, that resonated so much. I was like,
This is exactly how we should run, you know, how we should build software. And I came back after 15 months of traveling in the same company, on the same program, the sinking Titanic crappy program. But I had a new boss at that time. And I don't know, I got lucky because my new boss had been exposed to Agile when he worked in the US in the late 90s, especially extreme programming. And I told him, hey Olivier, listen, I'm okay to leave this program again, but let's do it in another way. Let's try Agile. He said, oh, Sylvain, I mean, we have nothing to lose. So yeah, go for it. Let's give it a go. So basically he, you know, he protected me for a few months. And call it beginner's luck, it worked. And actually it worked, you know, beyond our wildest expectations. Within less than a year, like nine months, we restored profitability. We had been losing millions, and it was a fairly small company for the past 5 or 6 years. And within 9 months, we restored profitability, the quality improved, the client was like, hey guys, what has changed? So we restored trust and credibility, and the quality, quality improved, and people started enjoying again, you know, working together and delivering software. So I became Mr. Agile. And so from program manager, I slowly transitioned to training. I took my Scrum Master certification. I attended events like this, and I learned from other people. And so that's how I slowly transitioned to less and less program management and more Agile. And I trained many teams and on many projects. I did that for the next 2 or 3 years. And then the word coaching, kept coming up. Like the Scrum Master is the coach of the team. I kept meeting Agile coaches in events. And to me, I guess what I had in mind at that time was the sports coach. I was like, you know, someone who shares his experience, someone who energizes the team, someone who protects the team. So to me, I guess an Agile coach was a kind of senior Agile practitioner. So one day, in 2010, quite a while ago, I remember it was a Sunday morning, I took a big decision. So what I did is that I hope the video is going to work. I opened my web browser, type linkedin.com. I don't remember what was my job title at that time, whether it's Scrum Master or Agile Project Manager or whatever. I put Agile Coach, hit save, and voila, I'm an Agile Coach. Forget everything, said yesterday, you need to learn this, learn that, do this, do that. This is the bulletproof technique. Update your LinkedIn profile, put Agile Coach. That's it. I'm sure I'm not the first one to do that. I was wrong. I was really, really wrong. But, to my defense, I didn't know. I really, really thought that I had to become an Agile Coach at that time. That's Sunday, 2010. I was really, really wrong because a few weeks after that, I took a course with this woman. So her name is Véronique Messager. She's the mother of Agile coaching in France. Basically, she wrote to the kind of our Lisa Akin. So she wrote the first book about Agile coaching, Agile teams in France.
And I think it's a speed as well. It's just something about like the Scrum Master as the team coach. And I was blown away. I was really blown away. Her reason, the kind of question, right? Really, I felt so empowered. I found answers in questions that I had been studying with for months or even for years. And I realized that, it's like, the art of initiating a significant conversation. And I realized that, so this is the day I realized I was not an agile coach, by the way. This day, probably around late 2010, early 2011. And I'm not there yet. I'm not there yet at all. And I remember she showed us something. And for those of you who went to Sackett session yesterday, so let me remind you of something. So basically, she said that Agile is all about the posture. And so of course, she said that there is a posture of the consultant. So basically, when you have a problem but you don't really know, what your problem is, or you know your problem but you have no idea about which solution you could implement, you bring in someone with the knowledge. A consultant. So basically, the consultant is here to help you define your problem and give you solutions. It's someone who has the expertise. Okay? Then you have the mentor. So the mentor is usually someone with more experience, a senior person, sometimes about to retire, and works with a junior or less experienced person, and basically teach by doing with you. Walk the path with you. The trainer, basically the trainer downloads knowledge, delivers knowledge. The trainer is not going to do it with you. Okay? And you have the coach. And also, if you remember what Sackett said yesterday, is that the coach, the posture of the coach is all about having the very, very, very deep belief that we are resourceful people. You have the answer to your problem. You have the answer to your problem. So it's all about trust. You trust people to have the answers. And really, you are here, you work with people as a kind of catalyst, a kind of, enabler. I think I heard this word yesterday in Sackett session. And I was like, wow, looks like coaching is, that's not what I had in mind. Now we are very, very far from the sports coach, huh? Very, very far from the sports coach. It looks like it's a very, very interesting skill set. I want to learn this. And actually, why do you think in Agile we need coaches, actually? Why consultants or trainers or mentors are not enough? Any ideas? Why do we need coaching in Agile? Sorry? Self-belief, okay. I got some. Very contextual? Yeah. Any other idea? Bring everyone on the same page. Thank you. Yeah, actually, the way I see it is that we deal with culture here. We deal with the how people behave, how people react in such situations, and we want to change. I mean, we know that the culture needs to change. And in order for the culture to change, you need to change the beliefs, you need to change the values. And that can only come from the people themselves. You cannot force change. I cannot tell you, hey, please change. Doesn't work. He's gonna change
if there is something, you know, in it for him, if he wants it, if he has, you know, realization, like a aha moment, and say, oh, this is a new perspective. Oh, maybe we can do things differently. I'm going to try. I'm willing to try. That's why we need coaches in Agile. So, a few years before, I read a lot of stuff about Agile, I met a lot of Agile practitioners, and now I did the same thing with coaching. And basically, I met a lot of coaches, not only in Agile, but also life, career, performance, wellness, whatever. And I took a proper coaching education. So I went to the International Coach Federation, and I learned coaching. And today, basically, I want to share with you probably three aspects of coaching that, you know, really, really helped me, and I think that will help you as well. Very simple thing, but very deep. The first one is about, you know, knowing yourself. All right, I know that, you know, self-knowledge, self-awareness, this is a very, very broad topic, but you know that in coaching we keep saying that, you know, it's all about questioning, listening. So I really invite you to observe yourself when you interact with people. How do you ask questions? What kind of questions do you ask? Do you know the difference between an open question and a closed question? Oh, sorry, we made eye contact, so what's the difference? Yeah, so basically he said that a closed question, you know, it's a yes-no question, or just, you know, a date, or just, you know, a fact. Whereas an open question is, you know, you will gather more data with an open question. So an example is, you know, a closed question would be, have you tried this? Have you done that? It's a very, you know, manager-style question. You just want the data. That's it. Whereas an open question will be, oh, what have you tried? What are your options? What do you think you could do in such a situation? You know, it's really more like a probing question. A leading question, this one is very, very toxic. You know, a leading question is, you know, when you have the answer within the question. Like, oh, was she angry when you told her this or that? You know, when I tell her, okay, was she angry, blah, 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 I'm already, you know, I'm implying something. I'm hinting something. And we do it all the time. All the time. Our questions are loaded with assumptions that we vomit to the rest of the world. Huh? Sorry for the metaphor, but this is how it is. Silence. Silence is important. This is amazing how much information you can get by a good use of silence. Silence are just, you know, very small words like, and? Tell me more. Sorry, what did you say?
Someone else speaks of when you become silent.
Exactly. But when we give more space, you know, to the person we are interacting with, most of the time that person is going to use the space and give us more information. And quite often, if we have something like quite heavy, you know, quite difficult to say, we don't say it, you know, from the start. You know, we start by, you know, telling lies and a nice story, blah, 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 blah. We fill the space. But if you don't react, you just listen. And then, you know, the heavy content comes out. Your presence. I also invite you to question and observe your own presence when you interact with people as a scrum master, as a product owner, as a team member, as an agile coach when you want to, you know, you help people. Are you fully present? Are you here? Or are you already thinking about the next question? Or the next observation that will show that how smart you are? Hijacking, interrupting. I'm sure you all have a friend, you know, someone who, you know, you are telling a story, you are sharing something that, you know, really matters to you, and like, blam, within 2 minutes, your friend completely hijacks the conversation. And then for the next hour, you know, you listen to all the crap. Hey, you wanted to share something. And again, we do it all the time. It's me, you know, our ego. I'm so smart, I have so many interesting things to say. Listen to me. So this is really, really important as a coach. Have this awareness of your presence. You know? And are you always trying to, you know, bring back the attention to you? Always. I'm so interesting. The internal state as well, very important. You know, the internal radio, the internal chatter. What does it say? Are you fully open to, you know, to listen to the other person's perspective? Or are you like judging? Oh, this is so stupid. So I had a few realizations. Let me show you my dark side. I had a few realizations, you know, when I started working on this. During my coaching training, which is like several hundred hours, you know, of coaching. So you have time to, you know, it always sends you the mirror of your flaws and stuff. So I have time to think about it. And I realized that, yeah, I definitely tend to talk too much. And actually a lot of agile coaches, they love talking. So when I hire people, it's one of the first things I observe. Last week, I interviewed someone for an agile coach position. In 45 minutes, I asked 3 questions. So I know that the self-awareness is probably around 0. You know, this person kept telling me about how smart she was and how many times she saved the world. I'm not looking for superheroes. I'm looking for coaches. With agile expertise. And also people who, you know, they keep wanting to convince you. And that makes me think of, you know, Peter Senge in his book, The Fifth Discipline, about learning organization. So he says that, no, the problem is not that. People don't resist change. They resist being changed. And the problem is that a lot of change agents, because they don't have this, you know, these coaching tools, they really want to convince you that what you are doing is wrong, it's stupid. Don't track, don't do your burn down like this, don't do this, don't do that. The problem is that again, if someone tries to convince me that I become very nasty, I'm in defensive mode, like this. Don't change me. So I have good reasons. And it's true, these people have good reasons to do, you know, what they do. Again, it's about, you know, yesterday morning we talked about empathy, presence. So I was in that space of, you know, I'm okay, you're not okay. Because, you know, I'm the senior agile practitioner in the room, you are wrong, listen to me. I was in that space sometimes. I realized this. So all the great coaches, not only agile, but, you know, again, performance, life, blah, 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 well-being, and so on, all the great coaches I've met, they are on this journey of self-awareness, self-discovery. They work on themselves. And actually, a lot of coaches, they came to being a coach because they were doing this work on themselves. And they realized that, wow, this is so cool. I'm becoming a better person. I'm becoming better at interacting, connecting with people. So now maybe I can use this skill set to help people. So make yourself this gift to work on yourself. The second thing I want to share with you is the awareness of, you know, the many, many layers of communication. Communication onion or communication iceberg or whatever. So sometimes you have 3 layers, sometimes you have 4 layers or 5 layers, whatever. It's just, again, it's just having the awareness that very, very often we are at the, you know, the very, the top of the iceberg, the chit-chat. How was your weekend? How is it going? How was lunch? And we don't really listen to the answer, actually, huh? I don't know for you, but for me, usually I don't listen. It's pure social interaction. You know, like actually, I don't listen. All right, the next layer, it's a bit more interesting. You know, it's pure data gathering. But you are still very much in your space. My space. I want some information, so I ask. Okay. It's still very, very much self-centered. And again, in a few minutes, we're going to make a short exercise. I invite you to observe, you know, how often you say, I agree. Oh, I feel the same. Oh, that reminds me of blah, blah, blah. You're not listening when you do this. You think that you are listening, but you're not listening. Again, you are bringing back the attention to yourself. I don't care if you agree with me. I agree. No, I don't care. I just want you to listen to me. I just want to be heard. The next layer is about, you know, becoming aware of the emotions and the feelings. So you can use techniques like mirroring, paraphrasing. So you repeat. Want to make sure that you're on the same page. You can also use it with the body language. Mirroring the body language works very well. Tone of voice. Very, very powerful. Very, very powerful. The eyes. And then the next layer is really in coaching. That's where we want to be, at the bottom of the iceberg. Where is the belief system? What's your belief system? Where do you come from? What are your values? And this is where it becomes very difficult because, you know, you have your own belief system, your own values, and sometimes there is a big, big conflict, you know, with the person you are coaching. So you really need to be like, wow, super, super open, like pure, you know, empathy, pure acceptance of, you know, of other perspectives. It's all about perspective sharing. And I really like to see this as, you know, like, it's like I have my own bubble. So right now, just imagine that you have a bubble around you. Look, there is one here, one here, one here. Most of the time, I'm in my space, my own bubble. You are in your own bubble. Sometimes, okay, we just get a little bit closer. So in coaching, we really want to be in the same bubble. So it means that we need to be a bit closer. Is it a bit uncomfortable, huh? Yeah. Is it more uncomfortable now? A little bit, huh? Yeah. You know, it gets a bit more uncomfortable. So it's also about yourself, you know, create the space where, you know, it's safe for him to open up. And he won't feel that super, you know, uncomfortable because you are getting a bit closer, a bit too close. Okay? But it's only if you do this that you are able to tap into, you know, something deeper that will help you understand how this person sees the world. Understand his or her perspective. Okay. Let's try. Okay? So you're gonna form small groups or like I say 4 or 5 people. Maybe 5 is good because, you know, Five people, it allows you to have like 3, so 1 coachee, 3 coaches, and 1 observer. The rules of the game are super simple. And it's something that you can do with your teams, by the way. Very, very powerful exercise. So the person who is going to be the coachee, so the storyteller, just think about something you want to share. Can be something you are struggling with, but can be just, you know, like your latest vacation or last weekend or whatever. You just want to share something with the group. And the three coaches, you're going to ask questions, keeping in mind, you know, what I shared with you. Try to be consciously, you know, present. Think about your questions. Is it going to be an open question, a closed question? Am I, you know, is it a leading question where, you know, I put my assumptions in the question? So play with it. Be curious. Be open. Try. And then I just want you to get a feel of, you know, what a coaching conversation is. It's not a casual conversation. It's a very, very special conversation. Okay? One more rule. The person who says the story, don't talk. Just wait that one coach asks you, okay, what do you want to talk about? And then start interacting. Okay? We're going to do this for the next 3-4 minutes, and then a short debrief, and then I'll continue the presentation. Okay? All right. I don't want you to fall asleep now. So let's do it. Let's do it. Have fun. Try. Okay, now you can debrief. How does it feel to be a coach, a coachee, an observer? Okay, please come back here. Wrap up your conversation. Thank you. Hello. All right. This is very short. Of course, it would be way better to have like more time. But again, it's for you to get a feel of, you know, this kind of exercise. What's really striking when you are an observer, I mean, when you observe the whole room, is that if you do the exact same exercise without the instruction, after 10 seconds, it's like it's a huge mess, you know, huge mess. And by just, you know, like asking people to focus on, you know, their presence, the questions, actually the volume is quite low. You can tell, you can feel the presence, you can feel that, you know, like people are putting a lot of, you know, conscious intention, you know, presence in their interaction. And of course, the more you do it, the easier it is. Because in the beginning, it's like, oh shit, I need to ask the right question, and not a leading question, not an open question. You know, it's a bit, so in the beginning, it seems very, very difficult. But believe me, the more you do it, the easier it gets. Okay, I had a few dark side Sylvain. I had a few realizations that, I mean, we are very different creatures. So some of us are very much into the I feel, I sense. Some of us I do, you know, very, very much in the physical space. And some of us are more in the thinking space, you know, oh, I think, but, you know, analytical. And again, it's a model, so it has limitations. But I think it's a good model. And it's very interesting for you to, when you talk to someone, identify, you know, in which space is this person. So personally, I'm more in the IE, intellectual, emotional. I'm very, very at ease in this space. You know, I'm an engineer, so, you know, problem solving is super easy for me. So intellectual thing, blah, blah, blah. I think a lot. I'm also very at ease with emotions. So for instance, if a team member, you know, is having a difficult time and burst into tears and whatever, I'm super at ease with that. Whereas for some people, it's very difficult, you know, tears, difficult. But doers, for me, doers is difficult. If someone, you know, when I coach people, if someone says, oh, I want to run the marathon by the end of the year, I don't care. I want to triple my salary within 6 months. I'm not very good at that, the doing thing, okay? But if I'm not very good at that, I should do it more. I think it's Ken Beck, he says that if something is painful, do it more often. Yeah, I think he's referring to, you know, testing, automation and stuff. So if testing is hard, do it more. And then you will automate. You have no choice. So it's the same with coaching. If it's difficult to interact with some people, do it more. Get out of your comfort zone. If people piss you off, I'm sure there is someone, you know, at work or at home, you know, someone who pisses you off. It's your best friend, because it tells you something about you. There is something that, you know, gets you very angry. Try to understand what it is. This is great. This is a direct path to yourself. And again, so why is it so important? It's because, you know, in Agile, we deal with the culture, we deal with, you know, the what people do, but the, what they do is the result of their, you know, belief system and values. So if you don't connect at this level, that will never work. And that's why we have so many Agile transformations. I hate this world, you know. And they fail, you know, after a few months. Because basically people have implemented the recipe, the cookbook, the practices. Okay? The third tip, this one is very simple, but very hard to implement, is that, again, a coaching conversation is not about just, you know, a casual chit-chat. There is a structure. So there are many models. This one is one of the most famous ones. So basically, with your questions, try to cover, you know, the ground of the problem space. Where is the client? Where is the coachee at? Where is the problem? If you don't define it, you know, you won't go anywhere. Where does the client want to be? And once you have these, you know, two anchor points, what are the options? How can we get there? Solution focused. Again, that's what Sackett mentioned yesterday. We don't want to, the why, don't ask too much why. You know, when people ask me why, I get very defensive. Don't ask too much why. Be solution focused. So where are you? Where do you want to go? What are your options? And what is going to be in your way? What are going to be the roadblocks? And what are you going to do when they will show up? So this, putting everything together, is something that is called a coaching dojo, and you can do with your teams. I've been doing it for years, very, very powerful, once a week, once a month, whatever. Put the people who want to improve this together, or the whole team, and most of the time people are very willing to try. And, you know, teach them a few simple techniques, exactly what I taught, the kind of questions, the presence, and work as a group, a group of a few coaches, one coachee, and you can work on real problems. You can use it in a retrospective. A retrospective can be a coaching dojo. You know, we have an issue, and together we are like 3, 4, 5 coaches, and we help that person solve the issue. And that really, really changes the nature of the relationship within the team after a while. And you will see a lot of realizations about, you know, people will have about themselves. Oops. So holding the frame is very, very important, because I see coaching as kind of a game. So when I know that, you know, the client has, you know, an issue and blind spots, and with my questions, I'm like water. I try to cover a lot of ground, and by asking all the questions, at one point, I will find a crack, like water, you know. And I also try to be as open and as curious as possible, which is very, very challenging, more or less depending on, you know, your background. But I must admit that, you know, I have the tendency to judge, you know, again, because, you know, I've been doing Agile for years, blah, blah, blah. I have the experience, blah, blah, blah. So I tend to judge. So for me, it's a very interesting exercise to be very, very open, very fully curious. So don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you should coach all the time. As Sackett mentioned yesterday, you see the an Agile coach, so this comes from the Agile Coaching Coaching Institute. Yes, sorry. An Agile coach must wear multiple hats, and coaching is just one of them. Because, you know, in the beginning when I learned coaching, I was very, very excited. I wanted to coach everybody at work. I want at work, at home, everywhere. I wanted to coach everybody. And so what happened was that, oh, I have a problem, Sylvain. And I was like, yes. What are your options? Hey, Sylvain, I pay you to give answers, not questions. So that's the issue. So sometimes just be aware that coaching is not always, you know, the right posture at a certain time. So be, and so I'm wrapping up the now, is that think about, you know, coaching, right posture at the right time. So in the beginning, it's quite common that you need to do more training, more mentoring, more consulting, giving solutions. And after a while, you do more and more coaching. Okay? And it also depends on the organization. So on the left, it comes from, you know, a Reinventing Organization, the book from Frédéric Laloux. Very, very interesting. I'm not going to summarize 200 or 300 pages in 10 seconds, but basically, be aware that some organizations are more coaching friendly. And some organizations are not there yet at all. It's still very military style. So adapt your style to the stage of maturity of the team and also the maturity of the organization. This is very, very important. Ask yourself, what is the best strategy? Which hat you should wear? So these are my takeaways. If you want to learn more, I really invite you to read a few books. So my presentation, I will share my presentation with the organizers, and it's also already on the slide share. There are some further reading, there is a section of further reading. I really invite you to read some books about questioning, listening, take a coaching course if you want to learn more. I found that it's a great way to help the teams, and by doing so, you basically you help yourself. So to me, it's a win-win situation, you know, to learn more about coaching. Because I think that, you know, in the end, so this is a quote from someone I think who is quite famous here, okay? I think it's all about being a role model. So if you, in Agile, if you want more collaboration, you know, more respect, more trust, start with yourself. And if you show that, you know, the way you behave, the way you interact, the way you talk to people is different, people will notice it. And then they will start changing. Thank you.